Okay, here we go, part six. I had to get me some, I'll try to put up a little thing. Sam sells this cranberry pecan topping. And it says you can put it in salads, yogurts, and more. I kind of eat it as a little snack. It's got cranberries and pecans in it. And let me tell you, it's stinking good. I'll try sliding a picker. But it's like 1:30 here. I haven't eaten lunch. And I don't eat breakfast. So I'm on my like third cup of coffee doing these crazy videos. Here we go. This is great, great learning.
I would like to go back up this lane the way I can.
I would like to go. There's that word. Like. Wish. Hope. Maybe. You know, I want to do all these things, but this stupid horse won't let me.
Okay. So I'm going to take my hand here, and I'm going to pull him around.
I'm going to pull him around. I would have said it. I'm going to take out the slack out of the rein. I'm going to make contact. I'm going to give pressure on the right rein enough and good clear direction to make his head face the direction I want him to go.
And once he turns around, now I'll release the pressure.
Too late. Because you're using one hand and you're not using two, you couldn't stop when he was facing the right way. So you confused him and you frustrated him by pulling him past where you wanted to go. Now he's confused and now you're going to have to recorrect him. You set him up to fail because you're using one hand and you're not using two hands to control him.
Pressure? No, sir. But look what he's doing.
Look what he's doing. Really? Look what he's doing. That stupid horse is doing this all by himself. Has nothing to do with me. I'm just the one in charge. I'm the one that saddled and put them, brought the horse out of here. But it has nothing to do with me. This is all the stupid horse. Look what he's doing. See how when you get into that, you don't even realize that you're blaming the horse. And you're saying this is a horse problem. This is a people problem. This is a Lester issue. Lester is failing to give his horse good, clear direction. That's why this horse is doing this.
So, no, sir, we're going this way. Man. All right, so I've released the pressure again. Every time. Come on.
See, he keeps calling releasing pressure instead of explaining that you release pressure when you get the right answer. He's releasing pressure when he, as a human, thinks he's facing the right direction, but he still hasn't got the right answer because he hasn't got the horse face where he wants him to go and moving in that direction. If he had two hands, he could face his head, stop it, control it, tell where it was pointed, and then give him the command or signal or cue, whatever, to move forward, and then he could release pressure. He's releasing pressure and blaming it on pressure and release, saying pressure and release is problem. I'm the problem. He's not blaming me. I'm kind of bullshitting with him. But look, it's not pressure and release, and it's not the horse. It's you. You are trying to videotape and use a shortcut one hand, and you're confusing the shit out of the horse, and you're not getting good results, but you can't see that, so you're going to blame, the horse, the equipment, I didn't do it. You're going to blame something other than you. And that's the problem. The biggest failure for people that fail with horses is they always look for something else to blame other than what's in the mirror. Look in the mirror, and that's where the problem is.
Think like a horse is not, oh, hell no.
He was about to crack on me. See, the horse knew he was talking shit. Good job, horsey. Horse distracted him. He was about to talk shit about think like a horse. And then all of a sudden the horse went, hey, you big dummy, I'll think like a horse. I'll go where you can't tell me not to go. I'll keep going back where I want to go because you're too stupid to get me going the direction I want to go. Because you're too damn busy videotaping. You don't give me clear direction. I'm going to show you. You know what? You can't control me with one hand, slick boy, pink pad boy. You can't control me with one hand, and I'm going to show you. This horse is teaching lessons, and I'm not sure Lester's getting them all. He's getting some of them.
Oh, no, sir. All right, folks, camera is going in my pocket because I need two hands for this.
Oh, my God, are you Hang on. I got a couple nuts in my mouth. I had to take some coffee. Are you... He finally got it. This is a light bulb moment for the stupid human. I need two hands for this. No shit. What have I been saying this whole damn ride? Now see, if I was there giving this immediate feedback, we wouldn't have to wait that long. So this, I mean, this is still good for Lester to figure things out. That's why I always say horses teach common sense. Because they don't care about your political bullshit. They don't care about your social bullshit. They don't care about what bathroom, what color your pad is, what you feel, what you want, how much you love them, how many cookies you... They don't give a shit about that. They care about what you do. And Lester finally figured out, I need two hands to stop this horse. Well, no shit. That's why you've been failing. That's why you frustrated and taught this horse all these bad lessons, is because you tried to take a shortcut. You tried to do more than you were capable of doing by filming and using one hand, and you didn't realize the problems that it was creating. Now, look, I get it. Lester's trying to show, and because he's doing this, it's becoming a great training opportunity for a lot of people who's had the exact same issue. Everybody, including me, has done the things that he's doing and has believed some of the things that he's believed. Because that's what's kind of taught, and that's kind of like the theme. And unless you think outside the box and you actually want to learn, it's just easier to listen to everybody else who's been doing it. Why take the time to learn yourself? Why take the time to do what's best for the horse when you can just do what everybody else is doing because it seems to work for them? That's the difference between horsemanship and people that own horses or showmanship.
All right, folks, let me get out of the shadow. So here's what I've done. I've gotten off the horse, and I took...
Oh, my God, Lester. Tell me you didn't fall for this stupid trick. All right. I hope people don't get mad because I'm eating. I'm just eating a couple of nuts and cranberries. People, relax. Here is where Lester is falling into the black hole of the horsemanship world, of the bad horsemanship world. If I can't blame the horse... If I can't blame the color of the horse, the breed of the horse, if I can't blame the last trainer, if I can't blame the conditions, if I can't blame the tractor that drove by, if I can't blame anything else, I'll blame the equipment. See, Lester, I thought he got it when he said I need two hands, but he didn't, because now he's blaming the equipment. He's trying to make this, that because I had this clip here instead of here, that was the problem. Not me. I was doing everything right. It must be these damn clips that were in the wrong spot that stopped me from being able to communicate clearly with my horse. Lester, you get a big fat F on this one. It ain't got nothing to do with these damn clips. It has to do with you. Quit blaming equipment and horses and breeds and colors and spurs and bits. This is the same logic where people get on a horse and don't know what the hell they're doing, and they rip the horse's mouth out with a bit, and then somebody tells them, you need a bigger bit. Oh, that'll fix it. It's not me. The bit's not big enough. It's not me. The clips were in the wrong spot. See how easy it is for humans to deflect responsibility from what they caused the horse to do? There's a thousand things to blame for failure with horses. And believe me, most of them have been used, but I hear new ones all the time.
Those clips that I had under here, hoping to avoid his face area, and I've put them on the sides of his halter. I thought to myself, this might allow me a little bit more control. And so I made sure that the little knobs are turned to the outside so they are not touching into his face. But I'll tell you what, the last part of this ride has gotten really sloppy.
What? See, another... This is when I tell people when they explain things on what happened with a horse, I don't believe it. In Lester's mind, the last part of the ride got sloppy. Who thinks the ride got sloppy only in the last part of this ride? Raise your hand. If you're raising your hand, you're a dummy or you're just trying to be nice to Lester. Because the whole freaking ride was sloppy because he wasn't giving clear direction because he had a camera in his hand and he was only using one hand. That's what made it sloppy. What made it sloppy is what Lester did. Not what the horse did. Not the problems he had. Everything Lester did wrong created problems, frustration, confusion with the horse, which complicated him controlling the horse, which means he had to use pressure and release what he thinks he was using pressure and release, and he was trying to do it one hand. He couldn't do it correctly, so he gave conflicting messages. The horse got confused. He got frustrated. The horse kept going away. He kept correcting the horse. Remember, if you don't set the horse up to fail, or you don't put the horse in a position to be corrected, guess what? You don't have to correct him. See, a lot of these horse, pink panty, crazy horse trainers out there running around selling their pink stuff on how great they are will tell you, you got to correct that horse. You got to show his boss. Got to be ready. Got to correct. Got to correct. Don't let him do that. Don't let him do that. Don't let him do this. Don't let him do that. They're all about that. Well, you know what? If you really understand a horse, you wouldn't set the horse up to do all those things. You would make the right thing easy. You would have a path to where the horse can only succeed. If you do it right, you don't have to correct the horse. If you give the horse proper direction and guidance and clues, and you keep him to where it's easy for him to find the right answer, you don't have to correct him. If you're correcting a horse, you did something wrong to let the horse get in a position where you needed to correct it. It's you. It's not the horse.
It's gotten really sloppy. And I don't want to end the ride on this note. Now, you might be screaming at the computer or your phone right now saying, he needs groundwork. That horse needs groundwork. Well, maybe so. But what's happening? But the problem we're having right now is not groundwork.
Well, I kind of agree. I disagree. There are people that think groundwork fixes. Groundwork is not the problem in this ride. Lester's hand work. His inability to handle the reins with two hands was the problem with this ride. He's got a lot of the basic concepts about pressure and release, but he doesn't fully understand how it encompasses the whole ride. And he's just thinking, I give pressure, I'll get the right answer, and then I give release when he gives me the right answer. He's not understanding how I use that pressure. And I think I talked about it in one of the earlier ones about a faucet or the volume knob on a radio. You know, a volume doesn't have full max or off. That's the only two volumes you got. Because everyone's different. So you can turn it up a little bit. You can turn it up more. You can turn it down. You can adjust it. And when you're working with a horse, you have to be able to adjust things. You can't be this stringent, like a lot of people will tell you. You got to show that horse who's boss. Get a bigger bit. Get those spurs on. Get that whip. You show that horse who's boss and they'll listen to you. They're a dumb animal and you just got to dominate them and beat them and show them who's boss and control them with pain. Big metal pain bit in their mouth. That's how you teach a horse to listen. See, you can listen to that philosophy or you can do it easier by being smarter. It may take you a little longer. It's not as fast.
It's him. In my opinion, having his own agenda.
See? Blaming a horse. So we went from blaming where the reins were to now it's the horse's fault for having its own agenda. It's the horse's fault for having a mind that he's trying to use. It's the horse's fault for capitalizing on your inexperience and your ability to control him. It's the horse's fault, Rick! It's not Lester. He's a good guy. You're just being mean. And it's not. Shut up, you freaking crybabies. It's Lester's fault. And he can take it.
And so I have the ultimate dilemma of at what point does he understand that we both have.
Holy shit. Is he listening to my videos? I just asked him to tuck that in earlier, I think, on the first video. You go, boy. Every once in a while, even a blind squirrel finds a nut, Lester. Good job.
I have an agenda. And I'm asking him to do what I want him to do. And I'm trying to do that with as much, quote unquote, pressure and release as possible. Yet, I feel like it's forcing me to apply a lot more pressure than what folks are going to want me to.
Well, first of all, it's not what people want you to apply pressure. It's the amount of pressure you need that the horse needs to get to the right answer the easiest. So, again, it's not this or that, it's a constant volume flow up or down, always adjusting. Sometimes I have to use hard pressure on Mr. T or Buddy. Sometimes I don't have to use any pressure. Sometimes I have to use light pressure. Sometimes I turn it up and I turn it down. So it's not this or that. It's always on a scale, and you have to be working to use the least amount possible to get the correct answer.
Because he's just being stubborn.
Oh my God. I hate it. Look at that knot. That is a sloppy knot. What the hell kind of knot is that? Shit, I hope I remember to go. But you know what? I'm going to find that picture right now. Now, I don't know why he's not using the snaps if he doesn't have holes, but he's using this type of knot here to secure his latigo. And the last loop needs to come in front, and then this piece needs to come straight down here. And then it should look nice and finished at the end, like so. His knot looked all funky and crazy and sticking out all kind of places. This is more of a, this isn't even as finished as I like it. I like this coming over this and this being narrow like a tie. This is even a little wide for me. Let me see if I can find a better picture. So this is done with a nylon cinch instead of a leather, and I don't like nylon. Nylon doesn't stretch. It doesn't give like leather. It's very tight. It may be stronger, but you can cut a horse in half, and it's not going to give, and it's... So I am not a nylon fan. When I see nylon, I automatically think there's a dummy that listened to some idiot that told him nylon is stronger than leather. And it may be, but it's not as good. It doesn't flex. It won't give. If he gets caught, a horse will kill himself trying to get away. Whereas a leather, it might break and he can get away and he wouldn't kill himself. So I'm not nylon, but this knot is the same knot, but it looks neat. It looks finished. It went up. It came around. It went up in the back here and it came down the middle. Hell, shit, I found this one. This kind of looked like Lester's knot. He must have got his knot from here. The hell kind of knot is that? So this one is about to finish. He's about to tighten it up. But again, it looks finished once he's tightened it up. It should look nice and tight and clean. Here's one that looks nice and clean. Notice how it comes around. It looks like a tie. And it's just, this is what's called a finished knot. You see the difference between this one and the knot that Lester tied, or the knot that other people tie. The way, when I say finished knot, that means I can tell this knot is tied correctly and it's secured because of the way it lays. It lays like it's supposed to lay, where things are lined up, which means the knot is going to be more secure and less likely to come loose. Not only does it look better, it's easy to do a visual inspection that it's tied correctly. Okay, I want to make sure you understand what I'm talking about when I'm talking about finishing a knot. So this is a bowline knot, very common knot, very useful around horses. I use it a lot because when a horse pulls on it, it can always come untied easy. This is called a load knot. So even under load, even if you pull a car, when I tow cars, if I pull a car out of a ditch or something, I use a bowline knot. Because when I tow a car out, I know it's going to get really tight, but because it's a bowline, I can always untie it. So I use this a lot when I'm tying a horse somewhere I don't want to get away. I know my knot ain't gonna come loose, but if the horse sits back on it and ties it tight, I know I can still untie it. So this little video here shows how to do it. You make your loop. The rabbit comes out of the hole, runs around a tree, and runs back down the hole. And that's your knot, okay? Up the hole, around the tree, and down the hole. And then it stops there. So let me get to the finish knot. So this knot is a bowline knot. I can tell by looking at it quickly, that's a bowline knot. I know it just by looking at it. I can tell it's tied correctly. But it's not finished. Let me find a finished knot. I was looking for a real knot, but this would be finished. I can tell by looking at this knot, it's a bowline and it's tied correctly. Just by looking at it. But it's under load right now. I was looking for an actual rope to show the difference. This one is hard to tell because it's red, but I can still look at that, know that loop around the neck there, that this is a bowline knot. Let's see down here. Man, I wish I could find a good one. Okay. Well, anyway, back again. I don't know what the hell kind of knot he tied there. It almost looks like somebody told him to put some damn slip knot, and when he came around the back, instead of coming through here, he put another loop. So maybe this is a slip. I have no idea. Just Lester, you can do a video on your knot. I wouldn't use it, but I'm going to do a video, and I'm not sure why you don't use these hooks. You've got holes in your latigo. That's what the buckle's for. This buckle is much easier. I didn't notice on your saddle if you had a latigo holder. I'll look as we move on.
I just think it's a lot of...
You do have one. I just saw it.
Because he's just being stubborn.
He's not being stubborn. Chew.
So
this little loop right here is a latigo holder. And if he uses this belt loop, and on this last loop, if he just puts this hook right in the hole that would be right here, he wouldn't need all this knot shit. Then he just runs the excess through his latigo holder and it hangs neatly and nightly. And it wouldn't cause a knot here when he's riding. So I would highly recommend you do that. He's not using his rear cinch, which is okay.
I just think it's a lot of stubbornness.
It ain't stubborn, it's you.
I think it's a whole lot of stubborn.
It is, a whole lot of stubborn in you.
All right, so we've come inside this back pasture here along with his buddies. And I know he's been wanting to come inside here. He's been riding the other pasture. Now we're gonna ride through here. But what I wanna do is leave his buddies and go down into the back. So now I'm seeing it again. He's being very resistant. Come on.
Well, if you're seeing it again, here we go, Lester. We call this a clue. Try to stay with me here, brother. If he's being resistant again, maybe it wasn't where the loops were. Maybe that wasn't the problem. Maybe.
I feel like I'm having to put a lot of pressure on turning him left and turning him back right because he's over exerting one way or the other.
Oh, that clears it up. It's not Lester. The horse is over exerting one way or the other. That's the problem. Damn. I've been missing it the whole time. It's the stupid horse for moving his head too far over after Lester uses one hand and yanks it too far over. That stupid horse. Vodoo, you're stupid. They need to change your name. Pink blanket stupid.
He's over pushing it. So so here we go. If I don't apply constant pressure, he's spinning all the way around. If I turn him and egg him on, he's turning too far. If I push him this way over here and then I release, he goes too far the other way.
He goes too far. He's spinning around. He's fighting. He's stubborn. He's not listening. He. And what am I saying? Lester. It's never the horse's fault.
No way. His ears are back. He's very annoyed with me right now.
No shit. So am I. If I was a horse, I'd be annoyed too.
I'm trying to walk him through this gate. He wants to be here with his buddies, though.
Can't imagine why. I wonder if his buddies yank him around and make him go left and right and too far left and right and left and blame him and call him names and call him stupid and call him stubborn. I wonder if his buddies do that to him. Working a horse and riding a horse is a partnership and it should be a relationship. It should not be a slave and slave owner mentality. I'm not saying Lester has that mentality. He's trying to learn. But I know a lot of people who do have that mentality because they can't accept the fact that they're not as good and they can't get better. Therefore, their horse doesn't do what they blame the horse because the horse doesn't do what they tell him, doesn't listen, doesn't follow direction. The horse is stubborn. It's his breeding. On and on and on.
I don't know if this is some kind of separation anxiety or something, but I think that the thing that I would like to be coached on.
I'm coaching you, brother. You ain't gonna like it. You may like it. I mean, you get it. I mean, it's not personal. Every rider who's ever ridden a horse has done this, except they haven't videotaped and used one hand. They'll make the same mistakes you are with two hands. And even if you do it with two hands and you don't get it and understand it, you'll make the same mistakes. The thing that you need to learn is it's always what you're doing. And it's not the horse.
In this situation, is how do you release the pressure, yet still have him go in the direction that you would like him to go? Because if I leave it up to him, I think we all see exactly where he wants to go.
I'll tell you how you do it. You use two damn hands and you don't videotape and hold a camera in the other one. Did I already say that? I don't want to repeat myself. I might have already covered that.
So I'm riding now with pretty loose reins.
You've been riding with loose reins when you didn't think they were loose. Your reins have not controlled his head the whole time. You've been able to correct and pull his head every once in a while, but you have not had good clear control over his head at any point during his, unless you did it with two hands when I wasn't watching or it wasn't videotaped.
But here we go again. Look at this. So we come to a crossroads. He knows that that way leads back to his buddies. This way leads down to the backwoods. So that's where I want to go. And so we have to make that decision. So what does he do? He stops.
We don't make decisions on a horse. You're the rider. You're the leader. You make decisions.
And his ears go back. So here's what I think Rick's going to say. Lester, read his body language. Oh, does he hear that noise he just made?
He did, and that was frustration, and he is frustrated with you, and I don't blame him. And you're not connecting the dots because you're changing the clips, and you're saying phrases that imply that even though you're not saying it's the stupid horse's fault, all your words is saying you're blaming the horse. And as long as you blame the horse, you will never accept responsibility that it's you, and you need to change, you need to do better, you need to do the right thing, you need to quit blaming a horse.
That's probably not boredom. No, sir. Come on. So I'm going to apply.
Okay, he said, come on. So come on must mean walk.
Apply some pressure and push him this way. I'll release it immediately. But you can see how hesitant he is. There we go. All right. Well, that was actually easier than I anticipated. Because I was reading his language, and I saw that he seemed like he was, well, he keeps looking back because he knows every step he takes is getting further from his buddies. And so this is actually not comfortable. This is not a comfortable ride, folks. It's not.
For once, he's thinking like a horse. Lester just made a comment that the horse is thinking. This is not a comfortable ride. See, most people, and I tell you, when they describe their horse as stupid, stubborn, and all the words they use to blame the horse, they're describing themselves. Lester just described what the horse was feeling, didn't even know it.
And so this is actually not comfortable. This is not a comfortable ride, folks. It's not comfortable because I'm having to go left and right.
See, now when it's not comfortable, it's because the horse is making him uncomfortable and he has to go left or right. It's not that I'm taking a shortcut by using one hand and filming, and I am not giving the horse enough direction and making it easier on both of us. It's the horse's fault that it's not comfortable. I hope you guys are seeing how easy it is to fall into that trap of blaming a horse or justifying your inabilities.
Left and right, left, right, left, right, back and forth with the pressure release, pressure release, pressure release. So, yeah, you can see.
Who thinks if Lester had one hand on this rein and one hand on this rein that he could keep the horse's head straight down this whole path? Who thinks that? Well, I'm telling you, it's damn true. And it's exactly right. He could very easily, this horse is not resistance or fighting him at all. All this is confusion and lack of clarity from him. If he put one hand on each rein and balanced the horse's head and kept, it's called riding between the reins. People will use that term sometimes, ride between the reins. Keep your horse's head between the reins. You keep his head between the reins by putting equal pressure on both sides when you need it. And then you release the pressure on both sides. And if he turns this way, you put a little pressure here. And if he turns too far, before he gets too far, you put a little pressure here. You guide and direct his head to where it points where you want to go. It's you, it's not the horse.
Oh, I have so many questions. And so, you know, Rick offered, he goes, Lester, if you want to come up, I can take you, we'll take my horses out and we can do some work. But that's not the thing. Rick, I'm sure that Rick's horses have already been well trained for all of this.
You're full of shit, dude. See, again, this goes into the defeatist mindset that people convince themselves. He thinks he can get on my horses because they're trained and ride them. Lester, I guarantee you my horses, both of them, would be doing exactly what this horse is doing to you. It has nothing to do with their trained. Horses are very smart and they figure out very quickly when the person has the inability or the lack of knowledge to control them or make them do something. And as soon as a horse knows, I don't have to listen to you, they will not listen to you. That's where it gets confused, where people are always yelling, show them who's boss, you gotta make them show. It's not all about that. It's about being a consistent, good, fair leader to where the horse knows, look, ain't no sense in really fighting or resisting this guy because he's going to win every stinking time. He doesn't have to win because he beats me. Doesn't have to win because he hits me with a whip. He wins because it just seems like no matter what I try, I always end up doing what he wants me to do. So I'm going to stop trying not to do what he wants. It's just easier to do what he wants. That's what you want. You get your ass up here and I'll let you ride either one. You need to watch the series. I'll put a link in the description if I remember. Let me find it real quick because I'll forget. You need to watch this series of this guy riding Mr. T. If you think because Mr. T is trained, I did an 8-part series on my buddy and he ain't ridden a horse since we were kids. And when he said he rode a horse as a kid, it was at this place where we rent him for an hour and we just sit around basically and follow somebody. So he hasn't ridden in probably close to 40 or 50 years. He's never ridden a horse without a bit. And I put him on Mr. T, and it's pretty much disastrous in the first one or two videos. And at the end of this video, which I think maybe lasted 1 hour for the videos, he was totally riding his horse almost like he had been riding his whole life. And it had nothing to do with Mr. T being trained. It had to do with him listening, and he learned. This is a great series. It's new guy with no horse experience, saddles up Mr. T and rides him first time. And you start at number one and you go through number eight. And if you think Mr. T is trained, watch part one and two and maybe three. I had to cut out some of the really bad parts because I was cussing and yelling at him for what he was doing to my horse. But let me tell you, it ain't the horse being trained. It's you. This is a great series for you to watch. All right, I'll try to remember to put a link. Hell, I'm at 30 minutes. When does this damn video end?